Welcome to Face to Facts. I am Nick Face. Sitting next to me on my left, once again, NORCAM's director of television, we'll like to call you, Phil Haley. How's that title for you today?
Well, I'm the public access coordinator, but we're all directors of television. I'm the most... No, I insert myself into the most situations.
I like that. Yeah. I like that. So today we're going to be talking a lot about, actually all four of our teams have something relevant going on with things. One ended the party a little bit soon, I would shall say. One, the party's still going. Mm-hmm. Another one doesn't know how to party. Oh. And the other one didn't have enough people to be at a party because they didn't have any picks. So we'll cover all the party people in just a moment. Let's start out with the Celtics, because the Celtics, I would say, for anything in sports right now, are number one, at least in this area, because their playoffs are still going on. So, Phil, have you got a chance to get any knowledge about or watching any of the games that have been going on?
Yeah, I mean, I was telling you off air, I was able, the full game I watched was, I believe, game four in Chicago, and I watched a little bit of game three, I think game one, and in a bar on Wednesday night of... Game five, which was kind of great. And I think I got in on that Avery Bradley like goaltending block, which at first was like, oh, that's not a block. It's not a goaltend, but oh, yeah, it's a goaltend. But it was an amazing statement block, and he had a good game. Horford had a great game.
Yes.
And IT has been pretty great. Isaiah Thomas has been pretty fantastic in this series.
Let's make sure we talk about Isaiah Thomas, because I've been the one that have said a couple times that
on this very
he
show,
probably might not be the superstar. I think it's okay to say that he stepped up the game this time and he's proven that he can get it done in the playoffs. Before everything was done, when the playoffs started, sadly, his sister had passed away.
Yeah, a day before. Yeah.
To be able to compete the next day and into this series the way he has, how do you do that?
I don't know. He just shut something down. I think he said it in a press conference about he shut himself down. He just like just went to work, and it's just like... you're somewhere else. And, you know, it was pretty abhorrent. Like, the cameramen were just, like, I think in game one, I think cameramen and, you know, whatever, TNT or directors were just pointing the camera at him on the bench, like,
crying.
And it's like, I understand they're trying to make it seem much bigger
that
than
dramatic
it is.
Effect.
Yeah, exactly. But it's still kind of like, oh, come on, man.
Leave him alone.
Yeah, a little bit.
But, I felt the same way.
But I
if you noticed,
what they're going for.
TNT was the one that did that,
sure.
Not Comcast.
Yeah.
Because the series is going on for Comcast. They get the local access right to do their games, which I love.
Which is great, yeah.
I wish we had Mike and Tommy or Mike and Scal throughout the playoffs.
I love Scal.
Because that would be amazing.
Yeah, no.
As a matter of fact, Scal was next door at the facility that I was at last week.
Oh, cool.
Got a little chance to talk to the giant leprechaun.
You did?
I did.
Oh, cool. What was his, any gleaming thoughts about
just stay calm. Stay calm.
Was that when
they were coming.
Down?
Don't worry. They'll be fine. Just kind of like that.
Yeah, yeah. No, I mean, it wasn't wrong. Well, what are your thoughts on when they were down 0-2?
I was surprised to see that the Celtics got down 0-2, and it was pretty much led because of Rajon Rondo.
Yeah, yeah.
Which I have never been a fan of his. I think I've told you that many times
I've
before.
Heard, yeah.
I never would have given him the captainship C on his jersey when he was a Celtic.
Was that when...
That was after Pierce and Garnett had left.
All right.
Rondo was not a team player for the Celtics. He wanted to be the superstar, and he's not a superstar. He thinks he is. His knowledge of the game...
I think he can be, but I'll let you go
his
on.
His knowledge of the game, I will totally give him that. But there are totally ways of Rondo wearing out his welcome. He wore out his welcome here with the Celtics.
Most definitely.
He didn't like Brad Stevens, I will tell you that.
I mean, I don't know that much, but I mean, it seems it's...
He didn't want to listen to his system or buy into the system. Yeah. It was his way, Rondo's way, or the highway. Well, he took the highway, went to the Mavericks, got traded.
He got traded, and we got Jay Crowder, and I forget who else in the mix.
And then he went to the Kings, wore out his welcome there.
Yeah, I forgot he, like...
And then went to the Bulls.
Went to the Kings for like a minute.
Yep.
And went to the Bulls.
Pair, Rondo and Cousins back then.
Well, they, I think they grew up together, I think. They played ball in like high school.
That explains a lot.
Yeah, well, and I don't mind. I think Cousins is a great player too, but it's the same affliction that he has.
They're hotheads, I would say.
Hotheads who, like you said, you know, their way or the highway. And Rondo, I'll disagree. I think he is a superstar, and he's a great point guard. But he just, when he wants to be, and that's the worst. That is the worst.
I like that phrase, when he wants to be.
Well, that's...
I will 100% give you that.
Well, And you know what? But that's such a crappy thing to be, or such a it pains me, because I remember watching him as a rookie, him and Jefferson before the next big three came along, and I'm like, oh, this kid can really like cut the defense, and he drove to the basket and dished it out, and he knew like he had a lot of quickness, and he still is a great rebounder. Like, that is not enough about Rondo. He can rebound the ball.
Rondo was one factor with the Bulls. The other factor that got really a taste of seeing what he's like is Jimmy Butler. Yeah. Now, here's a guy that the Celtics have really wanted on their wish list for a while. They had the chance, so they say, at the deadline to get Jimmy Butler from the Bulls, and they elected not to. Happy with that? Not happy with that? What do you think of Jimmy Butler in this series?
It's been all right.
Yeah.
Like, the first two games, pretty decent, and maybe because Rondo was setting the table for him or whatnot, but
it's gone downhill since Rondo's gone out, hasn't it?
Yeah, no, it has. I mean, Rondo was the field general. He was the guy laying out the, you know, putting people in the right place, making it happen. And I think Rondo was getting his jollies out of beating the Celtics. And I think that's, you know,
which I'm surprised with hearing this, because before this show had started, it was heard that Rondo will not be playing in Game 6. His cast had come off, but he is not playing in Game 6.
Yeah.
I'm stunned.
Yeah, kind of. I mean, if the Chicago head coach, who is kind of has been teetering on the edge of being fired throughout the whole season, if
that,
he really
his name
wanted
is
to keep
Fred Horsburgh?
Oh, something of that.
Fred Horsburgh.
I'm not going to try to pronounce his last name, because I forget it, but it is with an H.
Yeah.
And Erg is in it. But I'm surprised he's not trying to save his job by putting him in there. But,
right.
You know, maybe they win, squeak out a win, and then Game 7, it's all, you know, all or nothing.
I've noticed that the Bulls have been kind of complaining a lot, whining a lot about some specific calls. And
about traveling? Or just
traveling a little bit with Isaiah Thomas palming the ball.
Yeah, the coach, yeah.
Did you see at the end of Game 5 the press conference that Horsburgh had?
No, I didn't.
You didn't see what happened?
What did he say this time?
One of the reporters from one of the local outlets here in Boston goes, Fred, this is so-and-so from this affiliate.
Yeah.
Did you notice anything about Isaiah tonight palming the ball?
Yeah.
So, got off the stage, have a good night. That's what he said.
Oh, really? Off.
You didn't see that?
No, good for him,
I guess. Complete mic drop.
But I think
they have been complaining a lot.
Yeah, but I think that was a setup. I mean, that also was kind of a setup for him. But also, the coach should come to task to answer a question like that.
Sure.
If he put it out there.
He's the one that started it.
Yeah, he did.
Yeah.
And everyone in the NBA palms it, and Wade's pretty bad at it.
Yeah.
They all do. I don't care for it. I don't even know what the step once and then dribble.
Yeah.
And that changed a lot in, like, the mid-2000s,
They're not calling it, so it's legal as we know.
And it's the NBA.
So let Isaiah do his thing.
It's the NBA. The officiating is never going to be the strong point.
No, it's not.
So what other things were they complaining about? Like players?
There's been a lot of technical fouls. I don't know if you've seen
really?
A lot of that. Now, Dwayne Wade got a technical in Game 5. Robin Lopez got a technical. Mouthing off at the officials.
Oh, really?
Throwing their hands up. That's ridiculous.
Oh, wow.
So,
that's a little much. I think when you give when you give it, especially in a playoff situation, that's kind of crazy.
Then Jimmy Butler was talking about Marcus Smart, saying that Marcus Smart has a big mouth,
well,
and that he doesn't want to rumble with me.
He talks stuff. Yeah, that was funny. It's just a weird, and he is, Marcus Smart.
Yeah, that's what makes Marcus Smart, Marcus Smart.
Yeah, like you used the term hothead earlier to describe Rondo and Cousins, but, you know, Marcus Smart has that as well, and he can be a pretty great defender too, but also he's got to just cool it. He's just got to relax.
I look at Marcus Smart, to tell you the truth, as the X factor in the series.
Okay.
I think Marcus Smart has elevated his game a bit to be able to be trusted in situations with the basketball.
Okay.
You're seeing a lot of guys, it's their first chance to play in the playoffs. Isaiah's had his opportunities, but this whole crew on the Celtics, this is really their first time that they've had, you know, built under Stevens with a legitimate shot to win something.
Okay.
What I do like is how Al Horford's taken his game up to a new level after Game 2.
Yeah.
I thought Game 1 and 2 for Horford were terrible. I thought that there was a lot of question as to why he actually was here and got that big contract that he did. What I've seen from him has been able to help his rebounding to get better. I've been able to see him make big shots, get under, and make things happen. So I think that that's something the Celtics needed to see.
Yeah, I think he was, from what I saw in Game 5 highlights and when I was watching like the last 5 minutes of the game, he was making moves to the basket, and he was, he was making motion. He was creating space for himself down low. And that's, you know, he's a 6'10", and he's a wide guy. That's what he needs to do. And that's, I always hate when I see him, like, at the three-point line. I'm like, ugh. And it's just, like, because the interior just is,
well,
like,
he is out of position, we will say that. Yeah. He shouldn't really be the center. He shouldn't be.
Well, no, that, I mean, that's a fair point.
He shouldn't be. But the Celtics don't really have another option.
No, you got Amir Johnson, maybe.
He's done nothing.
And then,
yep.
And he's supposedly one of their best interior defenders, which he isn't a bad defender.
No, but, yeah, not at all. Another question I have for you. What do you think about inserting Gerald Green into the starting lineup?
I thought it was great. And I think it's so bizarre because I remember when he was a high schooler and he was drafted, and that was like Danny's big pick. Yeah, he was drafted in high school, I believe.
Yeah.
And I think he was in, I think it was right before the Big Three era, I think.
Yes.
And then he just kind of went the way of the Dodo and went to like eight different teams.
Right.
But it's kind of awesome seeing him back as a Celtic where he where he started. And getting like 18 points. He also had like three or four big rebounds in like the first half too of game four when they started him.
And I think it jump started the team.
Sure.
I think after the 0-2 being down, I think that they looked at all their options that they could do. And I give credit to Brad Stevens by making that big move. That could have been risky.
Yeah.
But he believed in the move. The move ended up working, and now he's a part of the starting lineup, which I think is great.
I think it's, but it takes away from Jaylen Brown a bit, who I would love to see in there more. I'd love to see both of those guys in there at the same time. They're very similar players, can be very explosive.
Yep.
And I don't know if Jaylen Brown is
I think what he was looking
for defensively, I don't know.
Was that veteran presence.
Sure.
And by having the veteran in there who's been around the block and knows what kind of how playoff basketball works, I think that's why Stevens believed in putting him in there.
Yeah, it's odd. Like, I don't see him. Maybe it's because I remember him just strictly as this kid, this high schooler who was on the team. Or maybe I also don't, you know, Gerald Green, like, what's he done? Kind of what, I mean, he's been on a bunch of teams.
What have you done for me lately?
Well, or just like, you know, what teams were, what teams had he been on that really, like, thrived?
True.
But, you know what, there could be some. I don't know right at the top of my head. But he played amazing on, in game four.
Yep.
And I imagine game five he did
pretty well.
Game
five he did great as well, too.
Yeah.
Anything else from the series that you have looked at player-wise? What are your overall thoughts, too, on do the Celtics get to the next round, too?
Yeah, I think they can. I stand by kind of my original. I think, and even Danny Ainge in an interview earlier this week had mentioned that, you know, they still haven't played their best basketball. And I think that's true. I think even game five was too close for what it was at home. They should have kind of, and I know, well, and Chicago's giving them a big swing, and I'm sure they'll get, it'll be tough to close out, and I think it is, I mean, we're filming this on a Friday of the game six, I believe.
Correct.
So I think it'll be tough closing out, but if they do, I think it'll be a big, I think it's a big test for them. So, like, I guess getting to the point, Bradley has been pretty great, and player-wise, it's been good to see them, and I stand by my whole thing. Like, I don't think the Bulls are that good. I think they're, like, any playoff team is a playoff team, but the fact that they got that much guff from them, it's concerning. But it's also the Celtics, I think, aren't necessarily a really good number one seed. I think they're, in the West, they'd probably be like a 5 or 6.
Right.
And I think, you know, enjoy this ride, and maybe they get to the next round.
Well, the next round would be either the winner. I was just It will be either the winner of the Wizards series or which is the Wizards versus Atlanta right now. Do you have a preference?
I'd like to see the Wizards.
Okay.
Because we've had a rough go at Atlanta this year, but I think we could take on Atlanta.
Yep.
But I'd like to see the Wizards because there actually is a little bit of history this year. Or, I mean, I say history, but they've been...
They don't like each other.
They don't. Yeah. And it's been great. They've had great matches. They've had great games. And Atlanta, they played well and they've had some good games. But the Wizards, it's like there's more there. I like Wall and I like... it isn't Beal. Who's the... who's the other guard? But I like that those two guards.
You like them?
Okay. I like the Wizards. Just as
I like the Wizards. I like to see that, too. I definitely want to see John Wall, and I want to see the rivalry renewed a little bit, too. So I think that'll be fun. So go Celtics. My opinion is that they'll win the game six. Series will end there, and the Celtics get a little rest for a little bit, and then they can get ready for the next round for round two. That's how I feel. Remember at the beginning of the show, I said one of the teams exited the party early. That is the Boston Bruins. They made the playoffs. They were facing off against the Ottawa Senators. They got it all the way to a game six. It was an up and down type of a series. I don't know how much you got a chance to see it, but I'll just give people a little bit of a recap. Plain and simple, the Bruins were in each game for the most part, except for game two, which they ended up parting away with. I believe it was like 5-3 or something. The officials in the series were terrible. It was completely one-sided onto Ottawa. There was one player in general that the Bruins were unable to really defend and stop. That was Erik Karlsson. Also, Bobby Ryan had some big goals for Ottawa as well in this. Three of the games went to overtime. So that's something to look at. We had one of the games go to double overtime.
Yeah.
So there was a lot of ice time, a lot of minutes for a team for the Bruins that were banged up, missing certain players. At the end of the day, they actually did compete with them. And I think that's the most important thing.
No, I agree. I mean, you said it pretty much. Three out of the six games were overtime. And Even the game two, 5-3, I mean, that's a little bit of a shootout. And, you know, game one, it was like, was it a 1-0 or 2-1?
I think it was a 2-1. Yeah, they won, Bruins.
Yeah, and they competed. If anything, You can say they played under this coach, and he was re-signed, right?
Bruce Cassidy is now the permanent coach, and I totally agree with that.
Yeah, no, I mean, they played under him. They enjoyed his what he was doing. And, yeah, they're like you've said, and I didn't even think about it until you mentioned it before we taped or began the show. They were kind of ravaged by injury.
Sure were.
And even Krejci, who was back, wasn't really himself. And
no.
He's an old guy. I mean, he's like in his 30s anyway. So
Krejci is about 30, but he's on the... They say that sometimes people are on the young side of 30 or the old side of 30. He's on the older side because he's so banged up. Yeah. He's one of my question marks on what he actually has left in the tank for the next coming years in his contract. He's the one player I would look in the team if his contract wasn't so ridiculous to part with.
Yeah. It's tough, and you got Chara too. You got to think about
Chara also said that he would like to continue be playing with the Bruins, so he's got one more year on his deal, which will be 41 years old.
Wow!
And then he would still like to play, so he wants to be Jager.
Yeah, you know what, Jager? Yeah. He played what, was it 20 something years or whatever?
Still going.
What and
still going?
Is he going to minor league or?
No, he's still playing professional hockey.
Where's he playing?
I believe he was last with Florida.
Wow.
Yeah, he's still playing.
Oh, good. Wow, good for him.
I think he's been playing in the league for 24 years.
Is he 50? No, he's 46 or 48?
I think he's 45, 46.
Wow, so wow.
Yeah, doesn't want to give it up.
No, I mean, if he can do it, if the body can take it.
Yep. That's incredible,
crazy.
Isn't it?
That's insane.
That is incredible.
Yeah.
He's like Tom Brady.
Yeah, pretty much. But not playing at the level.
No, exactly not.
But he's a good, I'm sure he doesn't play as much. I mean, clearly.
I don't think he plays as much, but he still's out there competing,
That's
doing his
crazy.
Thing.
Well, to the Bruins being banged up, I mean, what was your take from?
I love seeing Charlie McAvoy. That was my biggest takeaway from the series, was being able to see a kid who was playing BU hockey this year, being inserted into the lineups for the playoffs, and just looking like a seasoned veteran out there. Looks like he's poised and polished. Looks like he can really put the score and set up plays and everything. Trusted, which is hard to do when you first come up into the NHL. So I think the future looks very bright for Charlie McAvoy. I do, and I think the Bruins are going to like what they see there. Some of the concerns that you look for from the Bruins is I'm still concerned with Tuukka Rask. I'm still concerned. The last goal that he gave up in the overtime, which was against Ottawa, I was very concerned in his positioning on where he was.
He anchored himself pretty far right.
It was very far right when he should have been much more centered on where he was for kind of observing where the puck was going. I didn't like what I saw there. And it seems to me like Tuukka's got some sort of a mental block sometimes when he's the goalie. Is that a concern to get forward where you want to get a Stanley Cup? It might be. But I think that what they'll do in the offseason is kind of look out in the market and see who's available for a goaltender. If they can part with Rask and get somebody else in there, I wouldn't be opposed to it. I wouldn't. I do think that he definitely stepped up. Don't get me wrong. Here in the playoffs, he did a nice job. considering the Bruins were basically on a skeleton crew for defense. Yeah. So I don't know how much blame I put on Rask. I think totally game five, he won that on himself. He stood up and he just made it happen.
Two overtimes of just kind of getting throttled.
So I would like to be able to see a little bit more on Rask, but again, if the offer is out there for them to be able to part, I wouldn't be opposed to it. They definitely need to be able to look at some of their players that have been there for a while. I think it's time to look at Bergeron a little bit. Yes, he was banged up, but if you Bergeron and Marchand are part of your core players, you need to be able to get a legitimate person who can score. Yeah. Marchand did have a nice season, but he completely vanished in the playoffs.
Did they just kind of played him differently in the play? Did they just
played him the same? I just think that Marchand was in another land. He had so many missed opportunities; it was pathetic.
Oh wow! Well, how many points did he have?
I think he only had in the playoffs like 2 points.
Wow, really?
It was that bad.
That's not good, yeah.
That bad.
Not for him. He had a great season.
He had a great season. It seems like everything went downhill after he got suspended the last two games of the season.
Oh, really? You think that?
Yeah. Yeah. I don't know if that affected his skating that much, but maybe he was more concerned about the long term of maybe not getting thrown out of the league or something.
Not being
because
too aggressive.
He gets under a lot of people's skin.
Yeah, sure.
And he has been known to...
Yeah, he's their weasel. He's their...
Kind of ruffle the feathers a little bit, so to say.
He's their Marcus Smart, as it were.
Anything else that you saw from the Bruins? Expectations?
No. I mean, I only really like that game five double overtime is really.
That was a great game.
Oh, it was fantastic. Yeah. And like Charlie McAvoy had an assist in that. Like,
yes, he did.
And they changed the line and he came out and it totally revitalized them for that moment in that faceoff. Mm-hmm. But yeah, no, I thought they all, from what I noticed and from what I heard and read, like they all played for Cassidy. And like that's, I think that's a great sign.
They got a chance to play, unlike what they probably would have done for Claude. They would not play for Claude anymore.
And how are the Canadians?
Bye.
Did they really?
Done. First round and done.
How much?
They went to game seven. Well, yep. I believe it was against the Toronto.
Yeah, I think that was.
Yeah, so they're done.
Wow.
Yep.
Number one seed, right?
Number one seed. Bye-bye.
Wow. I mean.
Bye-bye.
Claude did a lot of good around here, but it.
Yep.
Yeah. What are you going to do? Well, I mean. Next season, we'll see.
We'll see what happens for the next season. So, one of the other things that we want to make sure we get to is the Boston Red Sox.
Yeah.
The Red Sox have their season going on. I'm not going to get to my side on how I feel about things. I want to hear what have you seen so far?
Well,
I want to hear your side.
I haven't seen as much as I could. I'm horrible on this episode. I'm sorry, people.
It's okay.
But
we'll catch you up to
speed. Well, yeah, I'm sure I'll gain a perspective on here. But from what I've been noticing, Chris Sale is 1-2. But he's only getting... Yeah, this is where I see you about to blow up.
Mm-hmm.
But he's been fantastic. He's been lights out. Mm-hmm. They just haven't been getting any run support. I notice, and from what I've seen, their pitching's been decent. Mm-hmm. Their bullpen's been okay. Like, it hasn't been the best. But, I mean, for what they knew they were coming into,
mm-hmm.
It's been all right. And their usual... I think Mookie's doing all right. I mean, I don't... It's just I don't hear anything or see anyone about anyone breaking up. I haven't been the only real thing I've kind of vaguely in the past couple of days or week or so been paying attention to is Chris Sale pitching. But
I will completely agree with you on the Chris Sale front. Chris Sale is somebody that you drop your remote, you take a seat on the couch or whatever you're doing and you watch him perform. He's an artist when he pitches. He knows how to paint the corner. He knows how to throw to so many of these guys. Again, last night's game, the Red Sox played the Yankees, and he just was absolutely the best player on the field.
Yeah.
Once again, the Red Sox don't give him run support. Listen to this staggering stat here. How many runs do you think the Red Sox have scored for Chris Sale since he's been in a Red Sox uniform?
You know what? I'll say 7.
That's low.
Yeah.
That's very low, but unfortunately, it's only 4 runs.
What?
They have scored 4 runs
and,
for Chris Sale.
And he's 1-2. And how many has he allowed?
I think like 3.
Like?
3 runs up.
3 like earned runs?
Yeah.
Really?
I think so.
For 3 starts?
I think he's in like a 1-point-something ERA.
Yeah. Like how many starts has he had? 3 or 4? Like?
I think he's started 4 times.
Wow. Oh, yeah, because he's...
Yeah.
Jeez.
So that's where we're at. I mean, the last game that he pitched before that was against Toronto when...
That kind of doesn't add up. I'm trying to figure out what... Either way.
It's
He's 1-2.
He's 1-2.
And they don't.
And it's staggering.
Yeah.
This is a Red Sox team that is continuing right now to search for an identity. They don't have an identity. The reason they don't is because the large father is no longer here.
Well, what would you consider an identity, I guess?
An identity is having the confidence in yourself to go up to the plate and have a strike the living the live of fear into somebody when you go up to the plate. Ortiz did that.
Yeah.
Nobody in this team has that David Ortiz style, oh, watch out because he could put the ball out of the park capacity.
Oh, yeah. I mean, down the line, who do you think has the potential for that? Or even just not even out of the park, but has, you know, a key hit written on him. Potential for that.
Right now?
Sure.
Nobody.
Nobody?
Nobody. Nobody.
Potential, though.
I'll push it with Mookie.
Really?
I'll push it with Mookie.
No, I think more than a handful
I do not like where Mookie is hitting in the lineup. I do
where
not. I absolutely hate the batting lineup.
Third?
Mookie
or?
Betts needs to be leading off.
Oh, okay.
Dustin Pedroia needs to be 2. Xander Bogaerts needs to be 3. Hanley needs to be 4. Not Mitch Moreland. Dummy Farrell. I would put Benintendi probably in the 5 spot. I might put, and then I might fool around with it a little bit.
Yeah.
To be able to give the Red Sox a little bit more balance. I can't stand it when he puts Jackie Bradley up higher than 6. Cannot stand it. But that's what they have to do right now because their team is so... They're struggling so bad to get a big hit.
Yeah.
They can't do it. They don't have that firepower to do it. So one of the things that...
It seems like they have a lot of good, just real ball and play guys.
They have contact hitters.
Yeah.
They don't have hitters that drive the ball for authority on a consistent basis. They have Mookie, who's getting exposed.
Yeah.
Mookie is catalyst number one for an opposing team that he's going to get pitched differently this year.
Yeah.
David Ortiz was the one that people were going to be pitching towards, and now the emphasis is right on Mookie Betts, Xander Bogaerts, those types of guys.
Yeah.
I think this team needs a shakeup already. It's early, it's April, I get it. But these games in April are still very important if you want to get to the promised land for the postseason. With how much is on your payroll, with the players that you have, if they do not get to the playoffs, it's unacceptable. The talent that came in with Chris Sale, Rick Porcello, David Price, all these guys that are atop your rotation, to not get to where you're supposed to be, that's just absurd.
Yeah.
You got to be looking number one at the coaching staff. Right now, if I was to be in charge, I would fire the hitting coach right now. Just get rid of him. Chili Davis. I'm not a fan of his.
Oh, Chili Davis. Yeah.
Chili Davis is the hitting coach. I would part ways with him, get a new person in there with a new philosophy.
The one man who ruined a perfect
game with
Pedro Martinez.
I would look to part with Chili Davis.
Yeah.
The next domino that would fall, I would look is Farrell. You know my feelings on Farrell.
Sure. Which I think is insane, but...
You don't think it's...
Well, no, I think... Listen, I think Farrell... I would have loved... What's his name? Lovello.
Lovello should be the manager of this team
He
right
should
now.
Have been when they had that opportunity to make him the manager.
Absolutely.
I think they should have. But that was a whole... But that also was a weird situation where he had to leave because he had cancer, and it just kind of like... It would look like a PR nightmare, and that's kind of what they're...
What the Red Sox should have done is put Farrell in the front office. That's fine, to keep his job. They should have put Lavulo as their manager because the players responded to him. You're seeing a team that's not responding to any of them on the staff. Did you happen to hear what happened last Friday in Baltimore with Manny Machado?
Oh, yeah.
Let's talk about this for a second.
Yeah, it seems like a cluster to begin with.
Right.
Just, I think everyone's just kind of like not on the same page. And no one's on the same page.
So what happened here is Manny Machado went into second base hard with his cleats into Dustin Pedroia. Pedroia had been out for about 5 days. His knee was swollen. Ankle was in pretty bad shape. The Red Sox took great exception to it. Now, there's a rule in baseball that says you are not allowed to go cleats into a second baseman or shortstop as a takeout slide. They call it the Chase Utley rule. Do you remember in the playoffs when Utley took out Ruben Tejada and broke his and fractured his leg?
This is why
they have that rule now. Looking at the play, they should have called the runner out. They should have called the runner out, which they did call the runner out.
He
but the
out,
runner
but,
at the runner at first should have also been out
oh,
too.
Oh, is that the penalty
that's what,
out? Is
that's
that what
Farrell was arguing so much about, okay. And they didn't give them that call.
Yeah, because it was the slide was in fact
the slide was interfering with the runner, and when you interfere with the second baseman being Pedroia, when you interfere with the fielder, that is against the rules of baseball.
Yeah.
Now I think the rule is stupid. I think the rule is stupid. I think the whole thing is stupid.
Okay.
Play the game. Dustin Pedroia said the same thing. He doesn't need a stupid rule
sure.
to tell him how to turn a double play.
But I understand if someone's like ramming. Like,
it's I not get like, it if you're ramming it. That's fine. Then it should be umpire's discretion.
I shouldn't have said ramming. I'm sorry, people.
That's
it's
okay.
Just, such a descriptive.
We're family friendly here.
Sure. Well, you know, not me, but... Nope. All right. So go. So you think like
I think. Why are there so many rules right now changing the game of baseball? Why are there?
Well, I think that because no one's watching.
That is true. But why? Why aren't people watching?
Because it's so damn long.
It is long. So would you cut? What would you do? Would you cut down how many games are in a season? How long a game is?
Maybe I might. Yeah, cut out April. Maybe.
Okay.
I mean, purists would hate me. Mm-hmm. But I mean, maybe not have a game every night.
Mm-hmm.
Although I do love that about, I mean, here's, what do you cut about it? Maybe you don't cut anything. Maybe you just wait for it to kind of right itself.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe you put a pitching clock. But I mean, even the pitchers aren't the worst. Sometimes the batters are the worst. Mm-hmm. And they had, you know, everyone's been through this rigmarole about like, what do we do to speed it up?
Yep.
Do we take a shave an inning or two? Or, you know, well, what about you? What do you think? What should we?
One of the things I do like with baseball, with the rule changes, is the instant replay. I like being able to see that, which is fine. It just takes a little bit too long to make the call. That does it change the game in a little bit of a capacity? It does, because it takes the heat off of an umpire if he makes a bad call. Yeah. Or if he makes a really good call your way, maybe he can come back and hurt you. So you never know on that end. But overall with the Dustin Pedroia play, I think that the Red Sox got a little bit too hot and bothered about it. I think they let their emotions get in the way, and there was some sort of hit Manny Machado the next time he's up to the plate as hard as he can to tell him not to mess with our, you know, Dustin Pedroia, our identity person.
Yeah, but they didn't even do it the next time he hit the
but
plate.
But that's on Farrell.
Yeah.
Farrell is the leader of this team.
Yeah.
And he went to Barnes or whoever did and said, you get a pitch right up and in on Manny Machado and let him pay the price that he did. And they flat out missed. Yeah. That is an embarrassment. I can understand if Barnes wants to drill him in, you know, the butt or,
Sure.
you know, back of the back or whatever. But going for the head is disgraceful. You do not do that. So Barnes being suspended for the 4 games, I think, is justified.
Yeah, no,
I do. I didn't agree with that.
No, I think, you know what? Anytime someone hits another guy on purpose, if they're going to be suspended, they should take the hit, take the suspension.
Mm-hmm.
But also, you do that knowingly. Like, this is part of my job. I have to do this.
Yep.
But, you know, I'm with you, man. I don't know why they didn't. This is what everyone's been talking about. It's been overblown and weirdly... I'm sure you can get to Dustin's take on it too.
Now Dustin Pedroia, when Machado was on the on deck circle the next time up, they're having a dialogue back and forth from the dugout. Pedroia saying, "Don't look at me." He goes, "That's coming from them."
Yeah.
So right there, that tells me that Pedroia is calling out his team, Barnes, Farrell, all of them. What does that say if you're a member of the Red Sox?
It says, you know, one of my veterans.
What are we doing here? I'm thinking.
Yeah, what are we doing? Or why the hell is our captain like?
Or so-called captain.
So-called captain, ratting us out. And I understand.
Throwing us under the bus.
Yeah, and I understand it's during the game and people can hear and see it. But that's the thing. Like maybe like, you know,
it
in
seemed
between
to me,
innings, you could be like, hey man, that wasn't me. That was more or less.
Them.
Yeah. Well, yeah. What?
It seems to me like Pedroia has some sort of a love affair here with Machado.
Or
why is it more important to satisfy him and make sure he's, oh, don't worry, Manny. Don't worry. It's going to be okay.
Do you think it's a satisfy
versus
him?
Versus satisfying his baseball team.
Well, do you think it's more interesting and more importantly, I think you're getting at the point, like his disassociation with his team.
Mm-hmm.
Like him just trying to separate from his team. Just as a general thing, regardless of the context of the situation, he's trying to separate from a decision. Like, why would he want to do that? He just feels like it's not, the team isn't maybe the team he thought it was going to be, or just the way
that's the type of situation for Pedroia, which I'm not happy with what he did. I'm not. He should have either called Machado after the game, texted him, say, you know, don't worry about it,
send
I'm sorry.
Flowers.
But you don't do it in a national audience right there. Because that showed me that this team 100% lacks a true identity with where they're going right now.
Cohesion, yeah. I mean, it didn't seem like it was something everyone, like, you don't have the manager being like, you know, don't.
Well, Mr. Magoo, John Farrell, I have a nickname for him. Mr. Magoo.
Because he can't see?
Magoo, I call him that because he has no clue how to in-game manage. No clue.
Now, that is unfair because Mr. Magoo was a blind man, a blind cartoon.
Was he blind?
He was blind.
Okay.
I'm sure he would have been a great manager, but in fact, his blindness is what kept him from behind. But you know what? I guess if you're blind, well, that raises another non-sports related question. Would your senses be heightened to a sense where I can smell, oh, it's in the air, you know, get wakefield out there?
See, I think Mr. Magoo would have had a better...
He might be a better manager.
A better sense at managing.
Oh,
I do.
Just like a people person. Yeah. But, I mean, regardless,
I liked John Farrell when he was Francona's pitching coach. I liked him that way. I did. But what I haven't liked with Farrell is his managing. Yeah. And it's been the same way since 2013. Now, again, I'm not going to take away that World Series championship in 2013. Farrell was the manager, and I get it.
Yeah, well, and some people say it was a
stroke
of luck.
They didn't win because of him.
Well.
They didn't win because of him. I'm sorry.
No.
The other seasons outside of that has been nothing but a failure. Last year was the first time they've been back to the playoffs since 2013. With the talent and the roster that you had, that is disgraceful.
It was pretty bad. Well, also the players. Sometimes it's on the players, too.
It is on the players, and I agree.
Yeah. I mean,
certain players. See, right now there are certain players on the Red Sox that I feel have that prototypical category called soft.
Okay.
There are soft players.
Who would be?
One of those players who is soft, and you're never going to be able to see this person take a leadership role or anything. The big one is Xander Bogaerts. He's a soft player.
You think you're soft?
I don't like to play in the cold. I like to play in the warm. Last night, I wish I had my phone, but I would have quoted. I would have quoted you something that he said after the game. We really miss David Ortiz. We really miss David Ortiz.
Well,
that's what he quoted in the Herald was saying.
Well, you know what? I mean,
we are really struggling right now without our leader.
Oh, did you say our leader? Is
yes.
That a paraphrasing?
Without our leader.
Yeah, that's something you don't want to say now.
How can you say that?
Well, you can easily.
Yes,
I mean,
he's being honest. I give him that. Honesty is the right policy.
Yeah, not always.
Not always, yes.
Well, yeah, all depends. Honesty is overrated in a lot of senses, but
can you say that?
No, you shouldn't. I mean, it depends, like, within the confines.
Because now it's got
team.
Me wanting to wear this shirt every day right now.
Yeah, man, I don't know. You shouldn't, if you really want to get together and find leadership, and maybe he understands, like, listen, I'm not a leader. But I shouldn't be, and maybe he's just calling out people to be a leader, but that doesn't seem like that's what he's doing.
No.
I mean, I don't know, I didn't hear it, and I don't know the context, but from your rage from it, it seems like.
Yeah, this is my rage today.
Well, and I
said it from a long time ago. A year ago, when David Ortiz, a little bit more than a year ago, when he said he was going to announce his retirement, I said, I'll believe it when I see it.
He's not coming back, man. You think he's coming back?
I still believe that he's going to come back.
Why would he come back to this?
He would have to come back to this because he still is fighting for right now going out not winning a World Series championship. I have heard directly from people that he is still mulling the opportunity to come back.
What?
He is eligible.
Name your sources.
Pedro is one of them.
What did
he
say?
He is extremely close with Ortiz.
What did he say?
David is training right now. That's why he's been so quiet.
Oh, my Lord.
So David is training right now to give his feet a little bit of a rest to see if he can really amp it up to get ready for the second half of action for baseball.
Man. What do you think would happen?
I think David Ortiz would come back and the Red Sox would get to the playoffs. Could they get to the World Series? It's a matter of how many people are going to jump on his back.
Well, then also, that's a Band-Aid.
It is a Band-Aid, but it's a Band-Aid that I think the Red Sox would want to take because they should have won a World Series last year. That was the goal. David Ortiz to retire was to go out in a World Series championship.
I think they would have gotten there, but I think it would have been a good series against the Cubs. I think the Cubs might have squeaked it out. But, you know, you make a good point. I mean, they supposedly
were
the best team in
the AL. Ortiz is furious. And he hasn't come out and said it publicly. But from people that have talked and that are close friends, he's furious he didn't get a ring out on top.
Well, he had a shot.
The season that he had.
He had a shot. He faltered on a number of opportunities in that series.
Yep.
I mean, they all
did. He did.
So, I mean, Yeah.
But I think what happened there, the reason why that series against Cleveland didn't go so well is because the Red Sox overdid how much of the gifts and the ceremonies and everything Ortiz had. It was emotionally dragging them.
Sure, and as another hot take from NORCAM Jason, as we will every time I'm on here, I'll try to drag his hot takes through,
good. We like hot
through
takes.
The process. No, but he felt, you know, that game where Kimbrel, and I've talked to NORCAM Jason about this all the time. I'm not a Kimbrel fan at all. I think he's got some great stuff, but it just seems like every time he's in there, I almost have a heart attack.
Yeah,
because it's
same
just
there.
Like he just doesn't know how to put people away.
He has no command of the strike zone on occasion.
Yeah, that's it. Seems like he's just like this Rick Vaughn kind of character. Great stuff, but just can't zero in. But NORCAM Jason had a great take about how that one game where we won, or we lost the game against New York, but we won the division, and we won the number one, the first seed, per se. We lost it, but we kind of limped in. And that was the end of our winning streak. And then we didn't win a game.
That's a great hot take because I completely agree on that.
Yeah, you didn't win a game after
that. Farrell comes into the clubhouse. Oh, don't worry. We just had a walk-off grand slam. We're going to celebrate and everything right now. That was wrong. And I talked about this with you and Chris and somebody else on the show.
And I didn't hate it, but I understood why it wasn't good.
That was a no-no.
Sure.
And you need to go out. You need to win your game.
Yeah.
And then you go out and you celebrate. You do not celebrate when you lose a game. You do not.
Yeah.
And that's part of the problem that what's wrong with the country and what's wrong with these kids right
My
now.
My Lord. All right.
I'm going to throw it all out there
I guess.
I am sick and tired of everybody feeling like they deserve a trophy. I am sick and tired of it.
No.
You earn it. You earn it. And that's what the Red Sox didn't do. So that was a great example of everybody gets a trophy. Don't worry. Gumdrops and roses for everybody.
I would love a gumdrop and or a rose right now.
Oh, you earn it, Phil. You earn
I think
it.
I have. Being me, I've earned it. But
wrapping up our Red Sox little segment here, the Red Sox face off against the Cubs. That's this weekend. I happen to be going to the game tonight.
Are you going?
I'm
I have
going
a buddy who's
tonight.
Going with this kid to the first Red Sox game Saturday night. So
that'll
Jeff
be Saturday.
Stern,
very cool.
You and Leo have a good time.
So is there anything that I should be saying to some of these players? Because I think they need a pep talk.
Well, if this weekend is
I was
going to
give Pablo Sandoval a pep talk and bring him a Big Mac from McDonald's.
Yeah,
but
I mean, that might help and hurt him. But
that's not going
to
happen
tonight.
Well,
what do you think you'd have to say to them?
Wake up.
Yeah, just
wake up. Around. Play the game.
Yeah.
Who's your leader? I might start that chant.
Yeah, well, who do you think would be the leader, though? I mean, that's another thing we didn't really...
It should have been Pedroia long ago, but obviously that he just does not want to be it. I think Chris Sale is. He's been here for a short amount of time, but I think Chris Sale is the...
Through performance?
It's the true performer, is the person that gets it, has a good head on his shoulders. I think he's the leader.
Wow.
Mookie could be one, but
I think
it's still...
Mookie definitely could be.
It's still...
He's a young guy, though.
A question mark on performance-wise for him. He's got to get out there and show that, put up those MVP numbers he did again from last year.
Yeah.
He's got to do that. I think it's either Sale or Mookie right now.
Yeah, I think you're right. I think Mookie, I mean, Sale's an interesting one.
Yeah.
But Mookie's
maybe Chris
be that
Young
guy.
As a veteran type, a Johnny Gomes style type of thing.
Yeah, I can see that. Or like
that could be something too.
Or who's Leon, Sandy Leon?
I can't speak English.
No, but it's great. Well, he speaks the language of baseball.
Yeah.
But yeah, I would love Mookie to be that. I think he could.
The whole thing that I'm looking for is elevate your game. Take your game to the next level. Grind out at bats. Put your teammates on your back. Get the job done.
And also, I think we need to qualify this whole conversation that it is the end of April. But like you say, games and they still count.
Game 162 is just as important as game one.
I would say no, but. I understand
they're
what
all
you're
important.
Saying.
They're all important.
We're all important little snowflakes.
So we wish the Red Sox luck against the Cubs this weekend.
Course.
Hopefully
have
they
a good time at the game. That sounds awesome.
Be fun. It should be fun.
Yeah.
Before we go, just the NFL draft was last night.
Yeah.
Overall takeaways from anything from there? Because I have some takeaways on the Patriots.
Well, you had said, and I think that sums up for me. I didn't really care as much. Because
I didn't really care either.
It's interesting. With the draft, a Mets on. I think it's kind of a fun thing. It's like a demon in its own right, where the NFL is just trying to suck more interest from people about it. And for a team that, like the Patriots or fans of the Patriots, mm-hmm. we're We're so numb to this draft thing, although it's another great thing. I'm like, oh, cool, what's going on? But the fact that we're not really that we're not a participant in
the
first
round.
Not until the third. And they only did the first round last night, right?
Yes.
And that's that because they've been doing that the last like handful of years. Like,
yep.
A big hoopla. Right as ESPN was firing a bunch of people.
Yes, that was eye-opening,
yeah,
too.
Well, I mean, they're losing money. Quite a
bunch of fools.
They're hemorrhaging. Yeah. Well, I mean, the market is a lot larger, and the share is a lot smaller for each individual outlet.
It is.
But it's kind of cool to see the machinations of what goes on. Like, the Bears are in a weird place where they get a new quarterback where they thought they had their, or they said to
Mike Glennon was supposed to be their quarterback.
They
so.
Assured him he was, and then they draft the UNC guy. And Myles Garrett, we'll see how Cleveland takes it. I kind of was hoping, well, I'm glad Garofalo is with us, but like you and I talked off air, you feel it's a bane long term. But I don't know if Brady will be playing past this year if he wins. I think he's done. If they
my hot take.
All right, yeah, go.
Actually, it's really not a hot take. I just wanted to say that. I'm very surprised Garoppolo and Butler are still a part of the Patriots.
I'm surprised Butler is.
Very surprised. Very surprised. And the whole thing. I'm going to start with Garoppolo first. Yeah. I've been all on the Tom Brady play until 48, 50 years old. I've said that a few times.
It's insane, but all right.
I think what the Patriots are trying to do is to stick it out one final year to see what happens with Brady. I think they feel if Brady goes out and performs up to the level that he did again from last year, then it might be okay to let Garoppolo walk. I disagree with what they're doing right now. I think that they should have traded with the Browns at some point to be able to give the Browns their legitimate quarterback they were looking for. They should have been able to take the picks in the first round and get some players to help balance out their roster. See, right now, I feel, Phil, is that the Patriots in the right now factor are great.
Yeah.
They have a phenomenal team. They have the best team in the NFL. 100%, no question about it. The problem here is it's for next year. They still have to be looking into the next years here with the draft. That's what it's about, building up your players and building up, you know, a good base so you can have a nice turnover.
Sure.
What this is telling me here a little bit is that right now it's all or nothing. They are trying to have another Super Bowl championship with Bill and Brady, and I think that they have a window here of 2 to 3 years that they want to do this in. So they want to go out on top and win as many Super Bowls as they can. So your point on if Brady wins another one is not out of the window.
No, I think that's exactly
that is something that could absolutely happen. I think that Brady ideally would like to play as long as he can go, but if he can go out one more time with a Super Bowl, it might be an option.
And I think,
and if that happens,
his wife has something to say about that too. So.
I think that she has a lot to say about it. I think if that does happen, then they can sign Garoppolo next offseason as their face of franchise quarterback.
Yeah, I think that would be fantastic. And someone said this on the radio too. You know, maybe Belichick maybe knows something that's or like has either talked to Brady about or has more of an insight as to seeing how Brady.
He
has
does
been
have
over
something going on. So
keeping Garoppolo is a telling thing.
I think it is very telling. I think it's a mistake because they should have utilized the picks and been able to build a little bit for the future.
But, I mean, what do you think they need for the future as far as...
Well, right now, I would be concerned a little bit on the... You know, they do have two tight ends. We've got Gronk and Dwayne Allen, but Allen's a little bit of a question mark here. I would be looking a little bit for the next tight end that could be a Gronk. Yeah. I would be also looking for your mid linebackers. They just signed Dont'a Hightower back. But again, Dont'a Hightower, he's been injured a good amount of times too.
No, he's
so
up and down.
So without Hightower in there, you got to rely on some first-year, second-year players that have to fill that spot.
And they have got a couple interior linemen this offseason. They got a couple, I believe, a gentleman from the Ravens who's kind of a journeyman.
Yeah.
And I forget a couple others. But yeah, no, but... It's always good to have a couple picks. I mean, third, if the draft is as deep as it is, I mean, maybe they get something good going. Maybe for the second round they pull something out. And maybe Butler does go to the Saints for like two or three like second round picks or like a conditional first next year. I mean, Who knows?
Well, I know that the Saints and Butler had agreed on the contract, on what they wanted in terms there. But problem with the holdup is the Patriots are demanding those first and second round picks for Butler.
Because they can,
and the Saints didn't want to do that. Mm. So that's why Butler's here. I don't know if it's a good move or not having Butler here. I think that...
Yeah.
See, my feeling on Butler is, yes, he's a great cornerback, but he's overrated. He had one great play in the Super Bowl, and kind of had his legacy.
I think he's a really good corner. And whether you don't have the option or luxury to kind of shuffle him off, mm-hmm. I mean, you can pay him a decent amount, and you paid Gilmore a crazy amount because you thought Butler was just going to walk. But, you know, Butler signed the tender offer, I believe.
Yep.
The tendered
offer.
He did.
Patriots control him.
Yeah, and like he'll be here for at least one more year, and let's hope he just kind of plays
and
it out.
And guess what
like,
they can also do?
They can also trade him, right?
The Patriots can franchise him the next 2 years if they want to do that, too.
It's true.
So guess what? He could technically be here for another 3 years at that.
No, he could, and like I don't know if he'd be... Like, for 1 year, I think we can deal with him being like playing underneath this... Just the kind of the hateful, the ire of hate in him for what happened. And he has every right to be angry about how the organization treated him, not really paying him. And they should pay him. And hopefully, if he doesn't get paid after this year, he goes somewhere else and gets paid. I mean, I agree to a degree what you're saying. He may not be like a number one corner everywhere, but he's a pretty good corner.
I got a good question for you.
All right.
Patriots still have Butler right now, correct?
Mm-hmm.
What if they don't trade him to the Saints? What if they trade him to something different?
Or to someone different? I mean, I don't know. I mean, then what does it matter?
Seattle Seahawks.
For Sherman?
For Sherman.
Well, that was something that was on, we talked about it briefly.
Would you do that?
You know, yeah, probably. For
I
Sherman?
Would absolutely do
yeah,
that.
In a heartbeat. I think Sherman
absolutely.
Is a, I think he's a better corner. He's a bigger guy.
Yep.
And I think you could, him and Gilmore, and hell, bring in
imagine
McCourt.
Sherman with Belichick
in
this system. Oh, boy.
Fantastic.
Butler, I'd pack his bags right now and drop him at the airport.
Yeah, I mean, I like Butler a lot, and I think he's done a lot for the team. And I think Sherman would be a great addition.
Yeah.
I think he'd be great.
So that's something that's still kind of in the oven a little bit.
They couldn't
so,
agree on, I guess they wanted a pick and a good player.
Yeah.
That's what they wanted
to Seattle. So, again, if you traded Garoppolo, you could have put that pick together and traded off to Seattle. But
sure.
We'll have to see what happens here. The Patriots will definitely still be involved with something, so stay tuned with everything going on there. Last thing I just want to ask, I know you brought it up in our segment we were just talking about, but all those layoffs from ESPN.
Oh, yeah.
Holy smokes.
Yeah.
That was a lot.
Well, I mean, they've been hemorrhaging money for a while, and they're just trying to, I mean, it's not necessarily, I mean, I don't know if it's bad management. I don't think so. I think it's just because the market, there's so many outlets, and it's like, the share for each network like ESPN is shrinking.
Well, I will tell you that I personally have not watched ESPN since the whole Deflategate with Tom Brady.
I've gone back and forth, but
the only reason that I have watched ESPN would be if the Red Sox are on Sunday night baseball or the Patriots are on, you know, Monday night football, something along those lines. But outside of like hearing sports and everything, no. Haven't touched it.
And you don't need ESPN in a lot of ways.
You don't.
Because you have your regional stuff. I mean, you can go... ESPN isn't horrible, but I mean, you could say they're horrible. I
think their reporters are so biased and one-sided, it's ridiculous.
They can be. I mean, you know, because they're in... I mean, they pretty much have deals with the NBA and the NFL.
Yep.
So, I mean, other regional places can be more kind of... I don't want to say the word hard-hitting, because it's... Well, sports journalism, you can't actually be a journalist.
But, right.
I don't know.
I just seen that I've seen them lose so much great talent. You know, one of the people that is now got his papers and everything to walk away was Jason Stark.
Oh, Stark is
Stark
great. Really? He
was
got fired?
Is one of the best baseball writers
and
in the country.
A decent basketball writer too.
Yes.
Yeah.
So that was a big one that was there.
I hope someone's got to pick him up.
Oh, I would hope so.
Like Yahoo,
MLB
or
Network, or something.
Oh yeah, MLB would be
so
a great
be
place
something.
For him.
The
He's been
biggest,
there forever, too.
The 17 years.
Wow.
The most telling observation about the ESPN.
Chris
Berman retired and everything.
It probably
I
said
think they forced him to.
Well, like, yeah, I think it's it's either, like, you can retire or you can be let go. And it's like, well. But, so who's the biggest?
The biggest news that came out yesterday was that ESPN is getting rid of their baseball coverage, except for Sunday night baseball.
Well, what other?
They're cutting Monday night Wednesday night, and a bunch of their analysts are being cut. Carl Ravitch from from Baseball Tonight is being reduced in his capacity.
Well, at least he's still there, I guess. Yeah. He's been there forever, too.
Forever. But the big thing is that apparently ESPN and MLB Network are in some sort of an agreement where they're going to bicycle the programs that they air on their network over to ESPN.
Well, I mean,
Intentional Talk is one of the shows that's going to be airing from like 4 to 5 on their network. I just think it's well, there's unbelievable.
Well, it's just people high value, they overvalue certain things. It's just like the NFL continues to grow, and like this makes sense with the baseball side of things because, you know, baseball's losing a lot of viewers. They got a lot of TV money in the last couple of years for the league and everything, but you know, it isn't a young person. The people who buy stuff that the advertisers are advertising aren't really there as much.
No.
And it's like when you lose it, it's so,
apparently, $700 million it cost ESPN to have their rights for baseball.
Wow, for how many years? Or is that yearly?
I think
it was
yearly.
Wow,
something like that.
Yeah, I mean that.
It was a fascinating piece to read with all the details and the juice that was in there.
Always look and read about what companies own what and who's paying what.
Yeah, it was very juicy. If you ever had a chance to look at it, take a look at it.
It's just interesting because
juicy fruit.
Juicy fruit. Gives you something to think about.
Absolutely.
Like where a source is coming from.
Well, I know what I'm going to be thinking about, and that will be tonight in my seat at Fenway. Yeah. I will be thinking about what I'm going to say to the Red Sox after I'm done.
Yeah.
I'm going to hope to get down to the clubhouse when I'm done.
Hopefully you have your phone and you'll check in on the Celtics.
So I'm going to be I'm hoping that the Red Sox can turn the corner here. Hope the Celtics can get their clinching game tonight.
Yeah.
And hopefully the Patriots are going to be able to do something.
They'll be drafting some people, and maybe they'll get something for the second round. Who knows?
Yep.
But if they don't make a move to get to the second round, I'm not worried.
Yeah, stay tuned.
Yeah.
Stay tuned.
Yeah, you never, exactly. There's always something.
Phil, thank you for joining us on Face the Facts.
Always
you kind of covered everything today, so now we can all take a deep breath.
Yeah.
Relax. Have a great weekend. Next time, we'll see you here on Face the Facts. We'll have another guest like Phil. Could be Phil again.
Who knows?
You'll have to see. Yeah. This is Nick Face again for Face to Facts. We will see you again next time. Have a good one.